lecture on lacrimal and orbital disorders. So this is a series of 8 classes, out of which we have completed cataract and eyelid. This is the third class. Okay, so today we will be talking about these topics. We will cover acquired as well as congenital lacrimal disorders, including dacryocystitis, dacryoadenitis, canaliculitis, then neoplasm of lacrimal gland. After that, in the orbital section, we will discuss about infectious orbital diseases like preseptal and orbital cellulitis, then inflammatory orbital disease like thyroid eye disease, pseudotumor, and at the end, we will talk about orbital neoplasm. Okay. So I have no financial disclosures and have consented for photographs and materials used. Before starting the lecture, I have this one poll question. Why is this man staring like that? He is having very starey look. Option A is he's angry. Option B, he has psychiatric problem. Option C, he has eye problem. You may answer them. You may answer them in the chat box. Please answer them in the Zoom chat box. For those who are watching by YouTube, you can answer them in the comment section. I will answer the question later on. Okay. So let's start with the brief anatomy of lacrimal apparatus. So lacrimal apparatus consists of mainly secreting glands and then excretory these passages. Tear secretion, they occur mainly from main lacrimal gland and accessory lacrimal glands. Main lacrimal gland lies in the superolateral part of the orbit in the fossa of lacrimal gland. And it has two parts. It has orbital part and palpebral part, which is separated by tendon of levator palpebral superioris muscle. The ducts from the lacrimal gland open into the fornices of the ocular surfaces. And there are some accessory lacrimal glands like gland of Krauss, which lies in the fornicial conjunctiva, and gland of Wolfram lies in the palpebral conjunctiva in the eyelid. I can get some background sound. Can everyone mute themselves, please? Okay. So the main lacrimal gland contributes for the reflex secretion of tear, and accessory lacrimal glands, they contribute for the basal secretion of tear. Once the tear come into the this ocular surface, by the blinking mechanism, the tear are sprayed in the ocular surface, and then by this superior and inferior marginal stream, they reach the towards the medial side of the eye, where it is drained by the lacrimal passage. The lacrimal passage starts with the punctum. Punctum continues as a canaliculus. Canaliculus has mainly two parts, vertical 2 millimeter part, which is also known as ampulla, and it continues at a right angle as a horizontal canaliculus measuring around 8 millimeter. Superior and inferior canaliculus, they meet as a common canaliculus and open into the lacrimal sac in about 90% cases. However, in 10% of cases, superior and inferior canaliculus, they may open separately into the lacrimal sac as well. So this opening between
All right. So, Savin sir, को मेरे वहाँ मतलब और क्या आगे तबर को मार दिए सर?
सावेज़ आना क्यों मालूम सर?
हाँ, मैंने आठ के.
All right. Let's wait for few seconds.
Thank you. Like and wait करो हम ना.
तेरी विलास में तो पहले मेरा feedback file drop कर दीजिए. फिर वाई फाइल भर्दै गर्नु होला है त सो तपाईहरुलाई अहिले के प्रब्लम छ वेबसाइटहरुमा भिजिट गर्नलाई त्यहाँबाट क्लासहरु पढ्नलाई के प्रब्लम छ के प्रब्लम छ त्यहाँ गएर पढ्नलाई भने अहिले शेयर गर्न सक्नुहुन्छ सो म लिंक गर्न गर्छु
हेलो हेलो
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry for the interruption. There was a power cut. That's why I have to connect with the mobile device. Okay. Okay, we will continue. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, as we were saying, Kapil ji, can you mute everyone, please? Please mute everyone. I am not able to mute everyone. Why? You can make me host so that I can mute everyone if I need.
You are already called, sir.
Okay. So let's continue with the anatomy. So as I was talking, the superior and inferior canaliculus, they open into the lacrimal sac, and which is guarded by a valve of Rosen-Muller. The lacrimal sac lies in the fossa, which the medial part of which is separated from the nasal mucosa, which is a medial nasal cavity, and then the lacrimal sac continues downward as a nasolacrimal duct. The nasolacrimal duct opens into the inferior meatus of the nasal cavity, and the opening is guarded by valve of Hasner. Okay, so this is the main lacrimal gland and accessory lacrimal gland and lacrimal passage consisting of punctum, canaliculi, lacrimal sac, and nasolacrimal duct. Okay, so now coming to the dacryocystitis. Dacryocystitis is a inflammation of lacrimal sac, and it can be congenital or acquired. Congenital dacryocystitis occur immediately after birth. It is present after birth or within few months of the birth. And acquired dacryocystitis, usually they occur in the adult. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, sir, you were audible.
Okay. So acquired dacryocystitis, they can be of two types, acute dacryocystitis and chronic dacryocystitis. So how do we differentiate between acute and chronic? So acute means there is sudden onset and the duration is less than 2 weeks, while chronic means that is of long duration and presents within or more with duration of more than 2 weeks. So those 2 weeks is the main duration time by which we differentiate whether it is acute or chronic. So now moving on to acute dacryocystitis. Common causes of acute dacryocystitis are acute exacerbation on chronic dacryocystitis, or infection spreading from the neighboring structures like paranasal sinuses, nasopharynx, conjunctivitis, etc. Common organisms are the gram-positive organisms like Streptococcus, Pneumococcus, and Staphylococcus. There are various clinical presentations of acute dacryocystitis. Mainly, they have three clinical presentations. Number one is the stage of cellulitis. Stage of cellulitis, in this stage, we can see the painful swelling in the inner canthus, which is at the lacrimal sac area. And there will be the surrounding area of inflammation in the soft tissue, which may be in the lid, and it may extend into the cheek in the lower part as well. The patient will complain usually of epiphora and sometimes discharge as well. Sometimes systemic features like fever, malaise, etc. may also be present. And the second type of presentation is the swelling in the lacrimal sac area and the swelling will be fluctuant in nature. Fluctuation is the main thing that you can differentiate whether it is abscess stage or cellulitis stage. So the surrounding inflammation will still be present, and patient will have watering and discharge as well. So third common presentation is the stage of fistula formation. Once the lacrimal abscess stage has occurred, if it is treated well in time, then it will subside. If it is left untreated, the abscess may burst and open into the open externally into skin and then form a discharging fistula. Or sometime it can burst and open into inside, causing the internal fistula. If it opens into the skin, that is called external fistula, and sometime it may burst open inside the nasal cavity or something, then that is a internal fistula. So how will we treat the acute dacryocystitis? It is infective condition. That's why the main treatment is oral antibiotics. Oral antibiotics covering gram-positive organism. So antibiotic of choice would be for adult ampicillin plus cloxacillin or amoxicillin plus clavulanate. And for children, tablet ampicillin plus cloxacillin 250 mg QID and syrup. Those who are unable to swallow tablet or capsule, syrup form of amoxicillin plus clavulanate 5 ml TTS should be given. Oral analgesic should be given since it is a painful condition, and antibiotic drops and ointment should be given, and patient are usually follow up within 7 days, and warm compression should be advised. So syringing is contraindicated in case of acute dacryocystitis. We should always remember this. And even the condition is very painful and it is tender in nature, so even sometime you may not be able to demonstrate the roplas, that is regurgitation on pressing lacrimal sac. And in case of acute dacryocystitis, syringing is contraindicated. Why? Because one, if you do the syringing, and the syringing may spread the infection into the nasal cavity as well as upper respiratory tract, as it is infectious condition. And for lacrimal sac abscess, incision and drainage would be done, followed by systemic and topical antibiotics. If lacrimal fistula has occurred, fistulectomy along with DCR or DCT surgery is done. Definitive treatment is DCR or DCT, that is dacryocystorhinostomy or dacryocystectomy, performed after acute infection is controlled with systemic antibiotics. Okay. Suppose this is a patient who presented with the stage of fistula formation, but still some upper eyelid swelling and swelling in the cheek area around the lacrimal sac area is present. So it was kept on the antibiotic treatment, and after the acute condition is over, usually it takes around 2 weeks of time, and after the swelling subsided, then we can plan for definitive surgery, either DCR or DCT according to the indications. Okay. So now moving to the chronic dacryocystitis, chronic suppurative inflammation of lacrimal sac. It usually results from obstruction of the nasolacrimal duct. It is more common in middle-aged women due to narrower duct diameter. So anatomically, these female are more prone for chronic dacryocystitis. So etiopathogenesis. Because of stricture or obstruction of the nasolacrimal duct, the content of the sac will remain stagnant. So once there is stasis of sac content, secondary infection by pyogenic bacteria may occur. Common bacteria that cause infections are Pneumococcus, Streptococcus, Staphylococcus. Okay, so these are the clinical presentation. You can see there is a presence of swelling in the lacrimal sac area, and this swelling may be accompanied by symptoms of watering and discharge. So in chronic dacryocystitis, it is of long duration and usually they are not painful, and we can see there is no surrounding inflammation or absent like in acute dacryocystitis. Okay, sometimes the swelling may not be so prominent and you have to look very carefully. If you look carefully, then only you are able to appreciate this swelling. And patient may complained of only watery without any discharge as well. So the main clinical features are watery, chronic mucopurulent discharge, and non-tender swelling in lacrimal
Hi, Dr. Savin. Okay. One second, he have a problem with the electricity, I guess. Hello, Savin sir. I guess you are muted.
Hello.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I was telling about the Ruppler's test, which is the regurgitation and pressing the lacrimal sac. On pressing the lacrimal sac, the content will come out through the punctum. Okay. So sometimes you may have false negative Ruppler's in conditions like if you press in the wrong side, or the patient have recently cleaned and pressed and cleaned the area, or some other examiners have cleaned and done the pressing already, then the Ruppler's may come negative. And in case of incisted mucosal also, Ruppler's may come negative. So three clinical stages of chronic dacryocystitis are the cataral stage, I'm sorry for the interruption, the network is not so good. Okay, am I audible now?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm sorry for the interruption. Okay. The three clinical presentations of chronic dacryocystitis are cataral stage, where only watery discharge is present, mucosal stage, where presence of swelling is present at the sac area and regurgitation tests are positive, and suppuration stage, where the lacrimal abscess result from the pyogenic region. So in chronic dacryocystitis, you have to do the syringing for diagnosing the site of the obstruction. However, sometimes it can be therapeutic as well, since it will the forceful syringing will open up the obstruction and it may be curative in early cases. Okay. Regurgitation. Okay, so management, definitive management is dacryocystorhinostomy and dacryocystectomy. Everyone please mute yourself. Okay, I'm getting some background sound. Okay. Dacryocystorhinostomy is the anastomosis that is created between the lacrimal sac and nasal mucosa to bypass the NLD obstruction, and dacryocystectomy, where the whole of lacrimal sac is excised and removed. So blood investigations before surgery are hemoglobin, bleeding time, clotting time, and to rule out infective conditions like HIV, hepatitis B, and hepatitis C. So usually in DCR surgery, some bleeding may occur. That's why this bleeding time, clotting time, and hemoglobin should be checked. And nasal examination should be done to exclude deviation of nasal septum, any growth, polyps, or presence of atrophic rhinitis, where DCR surgery are contraindicated. So these are some of the contraindications of DCR and indications of DCR, where DCT should be done and DCR should not be done. Okay, like old age and weak debilitated patient, DCT should be done. Previously, it used to be called that before 60 years of age, PCR is preferred, and after 60 years, DCT should be done. But nowadays, there is no such strict age criteria. If the patient looks debilitated on weak, then only you can go for DCT. Shrunken and fibrous sac, tumor of sac, like infective conditions of sac are also the indications for DCT. Gross nasal disease like atropic rhinitis is also contraindication for TCR and indication for DCT. So moving to the next topic, this is a congenital nasolacrimal duct obstruction, where you can see this newborn child. There is a presence of discharge and swelling is present in the lacrimal sac area. Swelling with surrounding inflammation is present, and the eyes are very sticky because of the discharge. Okay, so this is congenital nasolacrimal duct obstruction. Usually they occur due to membranous occlusion of valve of Hasner, that is the inferiormost part of the opening of nasolacrimal duct. Clinical feature, persistent epiphora, usually evident in second week of life. So usually, normally the tear are secreted in around 3 to 4 weeks of life. So before this period, if the child is complaining of any watering, then you should always suspect that it is pathological. Okay, it is never physiological. Sometimes you may be confused, the child may be crying, that's why watering is coming. But if it comes, but normally tear are secreted, and I mean tear production, they occur by 3 to 4 weeks of age. So you should remember that. So mucopurulent discharge may be present and swelling in the lacrimal sac area may be present. Treatment, conservative treatment in form of lacrimal sac massage and tobramycin eye drops is the initial treatment of choice. Most of the cases, they resolve within 1 year. And for those cases which are not resolving with massage, syringing and probing should be done at around 9 to 12 months of age. And one repeat probing can be done for case of failure of a probing. And surgery should be performed, like cystorhinostomy, usually done with silicone tube after 4 years of age, when the orbit and bony cavities are well developed. Okay, before that, if you do before that, the orbit is still growing. That's why you may not be able to appreciate better. So regular sac massage, how will you advise it? It should be demonstrated by yourself to parent and attendant properly. You should advise to wash their hand and keep fingernails short, and use index or little finger of the contralateral hand. Okay, if you are pressing in the right side, you should use the left hand. And if you are pressing in the left eye, you should use the right hand. Okay, and apply gentle pressure directly over the lacrimal sac and rotate in the downward direction. So this is very important. Even the success of this massage depends on how well you demonstrate it. Many patients and many attendants, they don't understand how to do proper massage. That's why it doesn't get well treated. Usual frequency advice is 3 to 4 sessions per day and 10 to 20 times per session. So you should say it little more. Okay, more you say, they will tend to do little lesser than that. That's why while advising, you should at least say 4 sessions per day, 10 to 20 times per day. So if you say more, at least if they do half of that, then the sac massage will occur. So if you say only 4 times a day, then he or she will do 2 times a day. Okay, so these are, so depending on the patient profile and how much understanding they have, you have to counsel them accordingly. And one thing you have to notice, don't apply pressure on the bone or globe, and downward movement on lateral wall of nose is not required. Okay, this is a common mistake where people do, like they tend to bring the downward movement and bring up to the tip of the nose like that. Okay, so that is wrong. So the main area, main pressure should be in the lacrimal sac area and slightly downward rotation. Okay, pressure over the bony nasal part is not necessary. So you should always check how they are doing the massage when they come for a follow-up and demonstrate it properly. So let's move on to the next topic. This is a boy who comes to the presentation of swelling in the lateral part of the eyes, in the both eye. Okay, this is painful in nature, and if you look at the lid margins, it is slightly S-shaped curve is present. Okay, in this as well as here. So this S-shaped curve is characteristic of inflammation of lacrimal gland, that is decryoadenitis. So decryoadenitis, they usually are caused by gram-positive bacteria. And treatment is done by warm compression, systemic antibiotics, and analgesics. So systemic antibiotics that cover gram-positive bacteria is similar to acute decryoadenitis cystitis, either ampicillin plus cloxacillin or amoxicillin plus clavulanate should be given. So one thing that you can remember is if there is symmetrical enlargement of lacrimal and salivary gland, you should always look for systemic evaluation. It may be associated with tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, or Hodgkin disease. This is called Mikulicz syndrome. Canaliculitis is an inflammation of canaliculus, most commonly caused by gram-positive bacillus infection, usually by Actinomyces israeli is the species. Clinical feature, they have red eye, watering and discharge, punctum may appear swollen, red and dilated or pouting may be present, purulent discharge may be present on pressing near the punctum. So they are treated by warm compress, digital massage, topical and systemic antibiotics. And for the cases which is not resolving with this conservative treatment, surgery in form of canaliculotomy or canalicular exploration and curettes can be done. Okay, so this is a middle-aged lady who presented with slight swelling up at the region of the punctum, near the punctum. Okay, if you look very carefully, then only you are able to appreciate the condition. But if you pull the lower lid and see that there is a and press a little bit, there is expression of discharge from the punctum. So this is called pouting punctum. And okay, I have reported one case, some cases where the canalicular curettes was done to resolve the case. Okay, like this case, in that case, 35-year female who presented with recurrent canaliculitis for last 6 months, and she was prescribed different antibiotics and she felt okay till the antibiotic was she was taking antibiotic, and once the antibiotic are stopped, again such canaliculitis occurred. So after multiple visits in our hospital and even visit to other hospitals, then she finally came to me, and I decided to do the canalicular curettes, and it revealed there was a presence of multiple small calcified mass. Okay, so these are the debris, calcified debris that are removed from the canaliculi after the snip punctoplasty is done. Okay, the patient had good post-operative recovery, and such canaliculitis did not occur later. So lacrimal gland tumors, common types are pleomorphic adenoma, benign mixed tumor, adenoid cystic carcinoma, and lymphoma. These are the main three types of the lacrimal gland tumors that may present. Pleomorphic adenoma is the most common benign tumor, and adenoid cystic carcinoma is the most common malignant tumor. It has worse prognosis. Okay. So clinical features, in general, they will have lateral upper eyelid swelling with enlargement of lacrimal gland. As mass grows, globe is pushed downward and inward. Other features like proptosis, diplopia, limited ocular motility may also be present. So investigation in form of CT scan orbit should be done for proper evaluation, where you can see there is a presence of swelling in the lateral part of this orbit, lateral and posterior part. So this is a lacrimal gland, and it is pushing the globe forward, causing proptosis. Okay, if you see this is an axial view and this is a coronal view. In CT scan, there are two views. One is axial view, one is coronal view. And if you see in the coronal view, this is a mass in the lateral side. This is the normal location, anatomical location of lacrimal gland, and this gland has enlarged to come into this orbit and displace the globe. Okay, so management, complete excision of lacrimal mass should be done, and followed by external beam radiation may be required sometimes, and sometimes neoadjuvant chemotherapy may be required. Okay, so is it clear up to now?
Yes, sir, yes. It's for me, but...
Okay, so let's move on to...
Okay, sir, okay.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay. So coming to orbital disorders, let's talk about anatomy of orbit in brief. Anatomy is a pyramidal shaped structure with four walls, base and apex. Base is the anterior most part that is surrounded by the orbital ring, and apex is this part where the lateral and the medial wall of the orbit, they converge from the apex. Four walls are the medial wall, lateral wall, superior and the inferior wall. And to remember it is around 40 millimeter in height, 40 millimeter in width and depth. That's an easy way to remember, but though it's not exact dimensions. Okay, the usual volume of orbit is around 30 ml or 30 cm cube, or you can say it as a milliliter also. And orbit volume of the eyeball is around 6 to 7 ml, and orbit is 30 ml. So around the ratio of eyeball is to orbit is around 1:5. Okay, so if you consider it 6 eyeball volume, orbit will be around 30. So these are the usual ratio. And if you note carefully, the two medial walls, they are parallel to each other, and medial wall forms around 45 degree angle to the lateral wall. Okay, so these two lateral walls, they are in right angle to each other. Okay, this is perpendicular, and two medial walls, they are parallel to each other. So this is how the normal orbit is. And if you look at the bones that are forming the orbital wall, seven bones, they form the orbital wall. In the roof, there is frontal and sphenoid bone, lateral wall formed by sphenoid and zygomatic bone, floor is formed by maxillary, zygomatic and palatine bone, medial wall is formed by ethmoid, lacrimal bone, frontal bone and maxillary bone. So out of this, clinically, we have to remember that medial wall is the thinnest wall. Because of that, infection from ethmoid sinus can spread to orbit, causing the orbital cellulitis. So the most common cause of orbital cellulitis is spread of this ethmoiditis, or infection from ethmoid to the orbit, because there is this medial wall is very thin, and some, that is also called lamina papyraci, that is a thinner part with some perforations or some openings in between. Okay, and floor or inferior wall is commonly involved in the blowout fracture. In case of blunt trauma, blowout fractures, they commonly involve inferior wall, however, and second most common is the medial wall. And lateral wall is the strongest wall, and easy surgical approach to orbit can be done through the lateral orbitotomy. Okay, so let's now move on to the orbital cellulitis. Orbital cellulitis is purulent inflammation of cellular tissue of orbit posterior to the orbital septum. Okay, so this orbital septum divides the main infection or inflammation into two parts, orbital and preseptal. If it is in front of the orbital septum, that is preseptal cellulitis, and if it is behind the septum, it is orbital cellulitis. And orbital cellulitis is serious condition where it may endanger vision as well as life. Common causes of orbital cellulitis, as I have already mentioned, most common is the sinusitis, commonly from ethmoid sinus, and then dacryocystitis, dental infections. The infections from these structures may go into orbit. Exogenous causes like trauma, orbital surgery may also cause infection. Endogenous causes like bacteremia with septic embolization may also cause cellulitis. Okay. Most common organisms are staphylococcus and streptococcus, gram-positive organisms. However, in children less than 5 years of age, haemophilus can also cause orbital cellulitis. Okay. So if you see at this picture, this is a middle-aged lady with the presence of chemosis. You can note the congestion and chemosis in the left eye. There is presence of lid swelling as well. And though you may not be able to appreciate proptosis in this photograph, the presence of proptosis was also there. Okay. So usually orbital cellulitis, they present with severe and sudden onset, unilateral pain, swelling of lids, watering, and diplopia. Congestion, chemosis may be present, and proptosis commonly occurs in the direction of, so usually it eyeball is this space, usually laterally and downward, and limitation of ocular movements may occur causing diplopia. Fever, malaise like systematic features may also be present. So treatment, since this is infective condition, antibiotic is the treatment of choice. Since it is serious condition, you have to admit the patient and do the frequent or early follow-ups. For severe cases, IV cefotaxime, that is a third generation cephalosporin, should be given in adult and children. Dose is, children more than 12 years, dose is 1 gram IVBD for 7 to 10 days, and for children and for smaller children, dose should be adjusted according to body weight. 50 to 100 milligram per kg IV BD can be given. After initial improvement, IV drugs can be shifted to oral drugs, either tablet amoxicillin plus clavulanate or tablet cefixime 200 mg BD for adult. And for children, it can be shifted to tablet ampicillin plus cloxacillin, or for smaller children, dose is different in syrup form. Okay. So metronidazole may be added for adult with chronic orbital cellulitis or anaerobic when anaerobic infection is suspected. Analgesics should be given for relief of pain, lead or orbital abscess if it occurs, then drainage should be done. Investigations, routine blood investigations for systemic infections like complete blood count, ESR, ultrasound B scan can be done to detect the orbital cellulitis. X-ray paranasal sinus and CT scan of paranasal X-ray CT scan of face and PNS can be done to look for sinusitis. And CT orbit should usually, it can be done at any time, but preferably if it is not responding to treatment or worsening with medical management, should be done within 24 to 48 hours. So this was the condition of the patient at the presentation. And after IV antibiotics was given for 7 days, and analgesic topical antibiotics was given, and this is the condition after 7 days. Okay. Preseptal cellulitis involves structures anterior to orbital septum. It presents with acute periorbital swelling, pain, and redness. Conjunctival congestion may be there, associated fever may be there, but globe and deep orbital tissues remain uninvolved. Okay. And fluctuating mass, if present, it always means there is an abscess formation. Okay, so I will tell the difference in the table in later between preseptal and orbital cellulitis. Most common causes of preseptal cellulitis are penetrating or cutaneous trauma or dacryocystitis in adult and sinusitis in children. These are also caused by gram-positive organism, staphylococcus and streptococcus. This preseptal cellulitis may progress into orbital cellulitis. So you should look for these features to check whether there is progression to orbital cellulitis. The features that we need to check are visual acuity, extraocular movement, pupillary reaction, temperature, total count and differential count, and degree of proptosis. Okay, so how do you know when it is progressing to orbital cellulitis? These feature, if it is worsening, then we may suspect orbital cellulitis is developing. So this differentiating table summarizes the difference between preseptal and orbital cellulitis. As we see, lead edema, chemosis, proptosis, they are more in the orbital cellulitis. Proptosis is present in orbital cellulitis. So globe involvement is not there, and muscle involvement is absent in preseptal cellulitis. So ocular motility will be normal, proptosis will not be there, pain and eye movement will not be there in preseptal cellulitis, while it will be present in orbital cellulitis. Vision is usually not involved in preseptal cellulitis, while it may be decreased or causing diplopia in orbital cellulitis. So RAPD may be seen in orbital cellulitis because of compressive neuropathy in the optic nerve, and lymph node enlargement may be seen in orbital cellulitis. Additional findings like sinusitis, dental abscess may be present in orbital cellulitis. Skin infection are usually present in preseptal cellulitis. Lab test marked leukocytosis, that is increased WBC count and very high elevated ESR will be present in orbital cellulitis, which is absent in preseptal cellulitis. Since preseptal cellulitis is an infective condition, so we have to give antibiotics, but sometimes IV may be given, but usually capsule or oral form of capsule or tablet may do the job. Okay. So antibiotics is same covering the gram-positive organisms like ampicillin plus cloxacillin. Always remember the dose is QID for ampicillin. Whenever ampicillin is given, and amoxicillin if it is given is TDS. Okay. And for children also similar. Oral analgesic, warm compression, nasal decongestant if there is associated sinusitis, and surgical drainage would be done if there is localized abscess formation. Okay. Now coming to this poll question, I had asked the question, what was the answer? I think most of you have answered it correctly. So he is not angry. He doesn't have any psychiatric problem, but he is having eye problem, which is thyroid orbitopathy caused by systemic thyroid disease. Okay. So Graves' thyroid orbitopathy, also known as Graves' ophthalmopathy or thyroid eye disease, or sometimes Graves' disease only. So it may occur in hyperthyroid in about 90% of cases. It can occur in euthyroid condition as well. In 6% of cases, and in hypothyroidism as well. So Graves' disease is the most common variety of hypertension, hyperthyroid state with an autoimmune basis. And typically, it affects the woman between 20 to 45 years of age. Okay, I would like to briefly tell about the pathogenesis, though it is a little complicated. So the basic thing you need to remember about pathogenesis is that it is autoimmune type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, where cellular infiltration and increased glycosaminoglycans component will occur, and osmotic imbibition of water will occur. So these are the three main pathological features, and because of these, there is inflammation and enlargement of extraocular muscles. Okay, this is a muscle, and orbital fat like adipocytes will be increased, orbital content will occur, and because of this, in the eye, you can see these features: enlarged extraocular muscle with orbital fat expansion and inflammation. Okay, so what will happen if there is increased orbital content and inflammation of muscles? Then there will be increased intraocular pressure, restrictive myopathy may occur, diplopia may occur because of restriction of eye movement, and compressive neuropathy will occur because once the optic nerve is compressed with the increased orbital content. So this is in brief about the pathogenesis. So what are the clinical features? Clinical features are bilateral proptosis, conjunctival congestion. In this photograph, you can see, okay, you can see both eyes are proptosed out. Okay, there is forward bulging of eye, conjunctival congestion are present in the both eyes, and periorbital inflammation is present. Lid retraction is present. Normally the upper eyelid that covers around 2 millimeter of the superior part of the cornea, but in this case there is lid retraction is present. Similarly, lower eyelid that just touches the limbus, but it is retracting. That's why there is a presence of inferior scleral sore, and extraocular motility may be restricted. Okay, so to remember the features easily, you can remember this no specs. Okay, no specs, though it used to be classified previously. Nowadays it is not so much used, but still it is useful to remember the features. Okay, sometimes there may be no sign and symptom, and only sign or earliest sign is the lid retraction. Okay, lid retraction is the first sign to appear in the patient with thyroid eye disease. There may be presence of lid lag or proptosis. Okay. And another feature is the presence of soft tissue signs. Okay, soft tissue signs, they may have symptoms of photophobia, lacrimation, foreign body sensation. And signs are hyperemia and chemosis of conjunctiva, resistance to retroplacement, and palpable lacrimal glands, they may be present. Okay. And along with that, other soft tissue edema like carancular edema, conjunctival chemosis, and this thing may also be present. Okay. And proptosis is the another feature. Proptosis are usually painless, axial, and symmetrical, but sometimes unilateral may also be present. And extraocular muscle involvement. The most common muscle involved, or most firstly, it will involve the inferior rectus. Okay, this inferior rectus is most commonly involved first, then followed by medial rectus, then followed by superior rectus, and then it will involve the lateral rectus in this anti-clockwise fashion. Okay, least common is the lateral rectus. So this is, you can also remember the same pattern in the occurrence of basal cell carcinoma. It is most commonly present in the lower eyelid, then medial canthus, then superior lid, and the lateral lid. Okay, if you remember. And corneal involvement, exposure, keratopathy, or dry eye may be present. Sightless may occur due to optic neuropathy or corneal involvement in around 5 to 6% of cases. Okay. So this is a photograph with only lid retraction. This is second photograph with presence of lid retraction and inferior scleral. So presence of lower lid edema, upper as well as lower lid edema, and some congestion is also present in the left eye. So this is a severe form where the, because of proptosis, exposure keratitis occurred, and that led to corneal ulcer, and ultimately this kind of condition may occur. Okay. So these are few signs. Okay, there are various signs in thyroid ophthalmopathy. If you can remember, there must be around 30 or 35 signs. But if you remember these 5 or 6, these are the most commonly seen. Okay, the most common scene is the dull rimple sign, that is lid retraction. Then upper lid lag and down gaze is von Graffé sign. Staring or frightened appearance is Cocker sign. Infrequent blinking or it is called Stellwag sign. Fullness of eyelid edema. Okay, it is also called eyelid edema. Edema is Inroad sign, E for E. And weakness of convergence, mobility problem, mobility for Mobius. Okay, so you can remember, somehow you have to remember these few common signs of this thyroid eye disease. So thyroid eye disease can be clinically divided into active and inactive condition. So how to divide it into active and inactive? I mean, active phase is a congestive or inflammatory stage where eyes are red and painful. While in inactive stage, it is also known as quiescent or fibrotic stage, where eyes are white and painless. So clinically, how will you decide whether it is active or inactive? By giving this score, that is called clinical activity score. So total of 10 points are present, and if each point is given for each of these points, this maximum of 7 points is there, and if 3 or more is present, then it is active disease. Okay, like the points are given to swelling of eyelid and redness of eyelid, then redness of conjunctiva, then swelling of conjunctiva and swelling of caruncle, then pain and spontaneous eye movement, and pain spontaneously, and pain when moving the globe. Okay, these are the main points. You score them. If it is present, you score them 1, 1, 1 like that, and you add the total sum. If it is more than 3, it is active. Otherwise, if it is less, it is inactive. Okay, I hope you understand this. So these are some essential points to remember about thyroid eye disease. The most common sign is eyelid retraction. Second most common sign is proptosis. Thyroid eye disease is 6 times more common in women, and smoking is associated with increased risk and severity of thyroid eye disease. Okay. Now coming to the management, how will you manage this condition? General measures like smoking cessation, cold compress, and head elevation should be done at the night time. For active disease, we should give oral steroid 1 mg/kg until improving, then taper slowly over many weeks, and along with the antacids. For dry eye and exposure problem, you have to give frequent lubricants. And if exposure is there, antibiotic drops and wind pain should be given. Lead taping should be advised, and tar therapy should be done for non-responsive cases. And there are some surgical management. Usual sequence of surgery is orbital decompression followed by strabismus surgery and eyelid surgery. Orbital decompression is done for optic nerve compression or severe exposure keratopathy or globe luxation, uncontrolled high IOP is present, or if the patient is cosmetically very concerned, then such orbital decompression surgeries are done. Strabismus surgery is done for diplopia, but it is done once it is inactive for more than 6 months. It should not be done in active condition. And finally, eyelid surgery is done for lid retraction or inferior scleral. So, investigations, thyroid function test consisting of T3, T4 and TSH should be done. And CT scan of orbit should be done to look for the enlargement of extraocular muscle and orbital fat content and status of optic nerve. Endocrine consultation for management of systemic thyroid disease should be done. So next clinical condition is idiopathic orbital inflammatory disease, which is also known as orbital pseudotumor. It is non-neoplastic and non-infective space-occupying lesion, mostly occur in middle-aged male and unilateral in condition. They present with pain, diplopia, proptosis, lid swelling, etc. And they have a dramatic response to the steroid. Okay, and CT scan should be done to differentiate there and to rule out the other conditions of proptosis and other causes first. Then is treated with steroid. So next one topic I would like to cover is the mucormycosis, which is very hot topic in this COVID time. So mucormycosis, what is it? It is also called zygomycosis. It is life and sight threatening opportunistic infection caused by fungus mucormycetes. Usually these mucor are present everywhere in the environment, but when the spores are inhaled by the person, then these spores get access to the body. And if the body is having low immunity, then it will cause severe disease. So when can this infection occur? Usually in uncontrolled diabetes, and nowadays it is seen in those patients who had a severe COVID infection, prolonged ICU stay, and then he has recovered from COVID. Then after that, he got this mucormycosis. It is seen usually like that. Or patients who are taking steroid for immunosuppression and have comorbidities like organ transplant, malignancy. These are the high-risk patient. Okay. So clinical feature, currently they are usually manifesting as rhino, oculo, and cerebral disease. Rhino means nose. Oculo means eye, cerebrals mean brain. Okay, rhino, oculo, cerebral disease. Ab ocular features ma ke huncha ta swelling of eyelid and periocular area huncha ani proptosis huncha and orbital pain huncha, redness, chemosis huncha, disorder huncha, sudden blurring of vision huna sakcha, restriction of eye movement haru bhayera diplopia huna sakcha ani drooping of eyelids huna sakcha. सँगै अरु ईएनटी फिचर्सहरुमा साइनोसाइटिस हुन सक्छ, नेजल ब्लक, ब्लडी, ब्ल्याकिस ब्राउनिस डिस्चार्ज फ्रम नोज, है नाकबाट सिगानमा पहेलो या एकेरे ब्ल्याक वा ब्राउन मटेरियलहरु आउने, त्यस्तै ब्ल्याक कलरको स्किनहरु देखिने फिचरहरु हुन सक्छन्। अरु फिचरहरुमा के हुन सक्छ त फेशियल पेन, हेडेक, फीभर, टुटेक, जो पेन, कफ, डिफिकल्टी ब्रिदिङ जस्ता फिचरहरू हुन सक्छन्। यो फोटोग्राफमा हामी हेर्न सक्छौँ यो कालो यो म्युकोजा हार्ड प्यालेटनिर हाफ प्यालेट सफ्ट प्यालेटतिर यसरी यो देखिएको छ, यसलाई भन्छ स्कार, है स्कार। यसलाई यो क्यारेक्टरिस्टिकली यसको कालो देखिने भएकोले यसलाई चाहिँ ब्ल्याक फङ्गस भनेर भनिन्छ। तर खासमा यो फङ्गस चाहिँ हिस्टोलोजिकली ब्ल्याक देखिने चाहिँ होइन, है म्युकर भनेको ब्ल्याक देखिँदैन। फंगस जसमा चाहिँ मेलानिन पिगमेन्टहरू प्रोड्युस गर्ने फंगसलाई चाहिँ ब्ल्याक फंगस भनिन्छ। तर अब क्लिनिकली यस्तो देखिने भएर कमन चल्तीमा चाहिँ ब्ल्याक फंगस भन्ने गरिएको हो, है त। ट्रिटमेन्ट अप्सन भनेको सिस्टेमिक एन्टिफङ्गल एम्फोटेरिसिन बी, जुन चाहिँ आईवी इन्ट्राभेनसली दिइन्छ अनि अर्ली डिब्राइटमेन्ट एन्ड इरिगेसन अफ साइनस विथ एम्फोटेरिन सी एम्फोटेरिन बी गरिन्छ विथ इएनटी कन्सल्टेसन है अनि एक्जेन्टरेसन अफ एक्जेन्टरेसन सर्जरी जसमा रिमुभल अफ अल अर्बिटल कन्टेन्ट्स गरिन्छ हाउ क्यान इट बी प्रिभेन्टेड प्रिभेन्सनको लागि रेसनल एन्ड लिमिटेड युज अफ स्टेरोइड अन्डर सुपरभिजन मोनिटरिङ एन्ड कन्ट्रोल अफ ब्लड सुगर हुनु पर्यो अनि अर्ली इएनटी एन्ड अप्थल्मोलोजी कन्सल्टेसन है कोभिड भएर निको भएको बिरामी छ भने अब भनौँ न 7 to 10 days अथवा अर्ली त्यस्तो सिम्टम हुने बित्तिकै चाहिँ इएनटी एन्ड अप्थल्मोलोजी कन्सल्टेसन गराउनुपर्छ हुन त अरू पनि गर्नुपर्छ लाइक अरू डिपार्टमेन्टहरू जस्तै डेन्टल मेक्जुलो फेसिलिटी सर्जरीहरू इभन सिस्टेमिक डिजिजको लागि अब जेन्टल फिसियनहरू इज अ मल्टी डिसिप्लिनरी एप्रोच हुनुपर्छ सबै डिपार्टमेन्टको एप्रोच चाहिँ यसमा रहेको हुन्छ है त म्युकर माइकोसिस इज नट कन्टेजियस यो एकबाट अर्कामा सर्ने चाहिँ होइन है तर इट इज एग्रेसिभ डिजिज एन्ड क्यान बी फेटल म्युकर माइकोसिस क्यान बी क्योर्ड इफ डायग्नोसिस इज डन एन्ड ट्रिटेड इन टाइम है त मैले एउटा यो फ्लायर पनि यस्तो बनाएको थिएँ कसैलाई सेयर गर्न मन लाग्छ भने सेयर गर्दा हुन्छ मजाले तर अथरको कर्ची चाहिँ दिने गर्नुपर्छ है अलवेज रिमेम्बर द्याट है कसैको केही लिएको छौ भने कपिराइट छ भने एटलिस्ट अथरलाई सोध्ने र अथरलाई चाहिँ भन्ने अथवा सेयरै गर्यो भने क्रेडिट चाहिँ दिन सिक्नुपर्छ द्याट इज गुड इथिकल प्र्याक्टिस है त अर्बिटल नियोप्लाजममा चाहिँ केही धेरै डिटेलमा नजाउँ अर्बिटल इम्प्लान्ट नियोप्लाजम भनेको इट्स भेरी ह्युज टपिक है आई विल जस्ट ट्राई टु कभर इट इन ब्रिफ क्याभर्नस हेमान्जियोमा भास्कुलर ट्युमरहरू हुनसक्छन् जस्तै क्याभर्नस हेमान्जियोमा हेमान्जियो पेरिसाइटोमा लिम्फान्जियोमा अर्बिटल भेरेसिस क्यारोटिड क्याभर्नस फिस्टुलाहरू हुनसक्छ भने न्युरल ट्युमर्समा अप्टिक नर्भ ग्लायोमा न्युरोफाइब्रोमा मेनिन्जियोमा स्वानोमाहरू हुनसक्छन् त्यस्तै मेसेनकाइमल ट्युमर भनेको त्यो मसलहरूबाट आउने ऱ्याप्डोमायो सार्कोमा इज अ मोस्ट कमन प्राइमरी अर्बिटल मेलिग्नेन्सी अफ चाइल्डहुड है अनि सडन अनसेट एन्ड ऱ्यापिड प्रोग्रेसन अफ युनिल्याट्रल प्रोपोसिस हुन्छ यो एकदमै याद राख्नु एराउन्ड 8 to 10 years बच्चा छ सडनली एकदम एक दिन दुई दिनको हिस्ट्रीमा चाहिँ ऱ्यापिडली प्रोग्रेस भएर युनिल्याट्रल प्रोपोसिस भयो भने क्लिनिकल डायग्नोसिस इज अलवेज ऱ्याप्डोमायो सार्कोमा है अनलेस एन्ड अदर it is proved otherwise so always remember this embryonal type is the most common type pleomorphic type is the least common and with best prognosis alveolar type is with worst prognosis treatment kasari garinchha ta combination of radiotherapy and chemotherapy and even surgery may be required in some cases hai ta tesai lymphoproliferative disorders haru present as a gradually progressive अनि पेनलेस मास हुनसक्छ अफन लोकेटेड एन्टेरियरली इन अर्बिट अर बिनिथ द कन्जङ्टाइभा वेयर दे मे सो टिपिकल सेल्मोन प्याच एपियरेन्स है सेल्मोन प्याच भनेको स्लाइटली पिङ्किस एपियरेन्स हुन्छ इन कन्जङ्टाइभामा एन्ड दे युजली मोल्ड टु सराउन्डिङ अर्बिटल स्ट्रक्चर रेदर देन इन्भेड देम यसको क्यारेक्टरिस्टिक फिचर भनेको अर्बिटल लिम्फोमाहरूले आइबललाई चाहिँ थिच्ने काम गर्दैन है आइबललाई थिचेर यसलाई प्रेस यसरी थिच्यो भने युजली सोलिड मासहरू छ भने यो आइबललाई नै यसरी प्रेस गरेर यस्तो सेप बनाइदिन सक्छ तर यो लिम्फोमामा चाहिँ के हुन्छ त भन्दा लिम्फोमामा आइको वरपर ग्रो गर्छ वरपर यसरी ग्रो गर्छ तर आइबल चाहिँ इन्ट्याक्ट रहन्छ आइबललाई प्रेस गर्दैन यो फिचर चाहिँ सिटी स्क्यानमा हेर्दाखेरि बुझिन्छ है त अर्को छ अर्बिटल मेटास्टासिस अर्बिटल मेटास्टासिस भनेको कुनै एउटा बडी पार्टबाट अर्को बडी पार्टमा टाढातिर सरेर गएको त्यस्तो कन्डिसनले भन्छ है यसमा चाहिँ शरीरको कुनै अरू बडी पार्टमा भएको ट्युमर चाहिँ आँखामा आयो भने त्यसलाई भन्छ अर्बिटल मेटास्टासिस यसमा के फिचरहरू हुन्छ त प्रेजेन्स अफ पेन प्रोप्टोसिस इन्फ्लामेसन बोन डिस्ट्रक्सन अर्ली अप्थाल्मोप्लेजिया यस्तो फिचरहरू हुन्छन् प्राइमरी सोर्सहरू चाहिँ ब्रेस्ट कार्सिनोमा हुनसक्छ ब्रोन्कोजेनिक कार्सिनोमा हुनसक्छ या प्रोस्टेट कार्सिनोमाहरू हुनसक्छ जसले गर्दा आँखामा मेटास्टेसिस हुने गर्दछ है त ल एउटा यो चाहिँ एकदम जान्नुपर्ने कुरा मोस्ट कमन कज अफ प्रोप्टोसिस भनेर प्रायः जस्तो अब एमसिक्यूहरूमा यताउता सोधिरहन्छ युनिल्याट्रल कज भनेको थाइरोइड अर्बिटोप्याथी बायोल्याट्रल कज भन्यो भने पनि थाइरोइड अर्बिटोप्याथी इज द एन्सर है त मोस्ट कमन कज अफ युनिलैटरल प्रोप्टोसिस इन चिल्ड्रेन ऑर्बिटल सेलुलाइटिस हुन्छ। बायोलैटरल कंडीशन भयो भने बायोलैटरल प्रोप्टोसिस को मोस्ट कमन कज इन चिल्ड्रेन भन्यो भने ल्युकेमिया और न्यूरोब्लास्टोमा। ल्युकेमियालाई क्लोरोमा पनि भनिन्छ है त। मोस्ट कमन ऑर्बिटल मेलिग्नेंट ट्यूमर इन पीडियाट्रिक एज ग्रुप भन्यो भने रैबडोमायोसारकोमा। मोस्ट कमन ऑर्बिटल मेलिग्नेंट ट्यूमर इन एडल्ट भयो भने लिम्फोमा, मोस्टली नॉन हजकिन लिम्फोमा। त्यसै मोस्ट कमन बिनाइन ऑर्बिटल ट्यूमर इन द एडल्ट भयो चाहिँ कैवर्नस हेमन्जियोमा। मोस्ट कमन ऑर्बिटल मेटास्टेसिस इन पीडियाट्रिक भन्यो भने न्यूरोब्लास्टोमा। मोस्ट कमन ऑर्बिटल मेटास्टेसिस इन एडल्ट भनेको ब्रेस्ट फलोड बाई लंग्स है त। ओके सो दिस विल इन दिस टुडेज सेशन।
All right, thank you so much, Dr. Savin, for such a wonderful session. So we are moving towards the next session, that is the discussion session. So I want to take permission with you to
share my screen. Let's move on.
This is the first question from our Noor. So can you see it, sir?
Yeah. Why is that 30% of newborn infant are believed to have closure of nasal lacrimal duct? I don't know this data from where you have taken this. I am not aware of this. 30% ma huncha bhanne testo kahi lekheko chaina. Yo huncha bhanne testo chaina. Okay.
So here's
how the
question.
Okay, Ajay Kumar Pal bhai, how dental infection cause orbital cellulitis? This is good. Okay, dental infection the daantaru huncha, daant ko root haru huncha ni, hai root haru chai te bhitra pani aba bhanau na abscess haru bhaniyo tinharu bhaye pachi tyaha bata swelling athwa tyo infection haru spread hudai hudai dental bata sinus ma jala, sinus bata orbit ma jala, tesari chai hune ho khas ma aba thakkai daant bata aankha samma aba त्यस्तो कनेक्सन सिधै चाहिँ हुँदैन, त्यो स्प्रेड हुँदै ठुलो हुँदै गएर हुने हो। नेक्स्ट, क्यान यु प्लिज डिस्क्राइब अबाउट डिजिटल मसाज प्रोसेस इन डिटेल डिटेल। आई थिङ्क आई हेभ अलरेडी डेमोन्स्ट्रेटेड एन्ड त्यसमा भनिसकेँ यसमा है, यसमा हामी डिटेल नगरौँ। पल्लवी, सम पेसेन्ट कम्प्लेन अफ एक्सेसिभ डिस्चार्ज, सो हाउ मच डिस्चार्ज इज कन्सिडर नर्मल? अब कति नर्मल भन्ने हुँदैन, एनी डिस्चार्ज इज एब नर्मल है, नर्मली त डिस्चार्ज हुनै हुँदैन, कुनै पनि डिस्चार्ज भयो भने एब नर्मल हो, यति उति भन्ने चाहिँ हुँदैन। सतीश चन्द्र, हाई डाक्टर सबिन, वाट आर द कजेस अफ कन्जिनाइटल डेक्रोसिस्टाइटिस? मोस्ट कमन कज इज द, अघि भने मैले मेम्ब्रानस अक्लुजन अफ बल्ब अफ फेसनर इज द मोस्ट कमन, युजली एनएलडीको इन्फेरियर पार्टमा त्यो चाहिँ ओपनिङ चाहिँ क्लोज भएको हुन्छ, द्याट इज द मोस्ट कमन पार्ट। कहिले काहीँ चाहिँ एजिनेसिस भन्ने हुन्छ, जुन चाहिँ डेभलप नै भएन, त्यो चाहिँ कन्जिनेटल एनोमेलिजहरू भयो, डेभलप नै भएन, अथवा फेसियल अथवा बोनी के अरे अर्बिटल एबनर्मालिटिजहरू भएको कन्डिसनमा पनि यस्तो हुने गर्दछ है त। नेक्स्ट, क्यान यु प्लिज एक्सप्लेन अबाउट एफटिटिटी एन्ड इट्स ग्रेडिङ? एफटिटिटीको बारेमा हुनु त म पछि भन्छु, क्यान आई ड्र, मैले यसमा ड्र गर्न सकिनँ है। एफटिटिटी भनेको फ्लोरेसेन्स डाई डिजेपियरेन्स टेस्ट हो, जसमा चाहिँ फ्लोरेसिन स्ट्रिप लिएर आँखामा लगाएर वी अब्जर्भ द पेसेन्ट फर 2 मिनट्स है, र त्यसपछि त्यसको 2 मिनट्स पछि चाहिँ त्यसको स्टेनको चाहिँ कतिको आँखामा चाहिँ भिजिबल छ भन्ने कुरा, त्यसको टियर फिल्म हाइट हेरेर चाहिँ यदि पुरै अब ट्रेन भयो भने ग्रेड 0 है, अनि थोरै थोरै मार्जिनल स्ट्रिप जस्ती मात्र छ भने ग्रेड 1, अनि एकदमै धेरै आँखा चाहिँ आई के अरे त्यो आँसु चाहिँ एकदमै छल्किएर झर्ला झर्ला जस्तो भएको छ भने ग्रेड 3 हुन्छ है, एकदम थोरै छ भने ग्रेड 1 र 3 को बिचमा ग्रेड 2, र 0 ग्रेड 1 र ग्रेड 0 भनेको नर्मल हो, ग्रेड 2 र ग्रेड 3 भनेको एबनर्मल हो है। यो चाहिँ अब युजली कहिले गरिन्छ त एफडिटी भन्दा, कहिले काहीँ एनाटोमिकली चाहिँ एनएलडी पेटेन्ट भए पनि कहिलेकाहीँ फङ्सनली उनीहरूले ल्याक्रिमल पम्प मेकानिजमले काम नगरेर चाहिँ ड्रेन गर्न सकेको हुँदैन, त्यस्तो फङ्सनल ब्लक छ यदि र प्यासेजहरू ठिक छ छैन भन्ने कुरा चेक गर्नको लागि चाहिँ यो फ्लोरेसेन्स डाई डिजेपियरेन्स टेस्ट गरिन्छ है त। next. What is the role of tablet metronidazole? Metronidazole bhaneko, it's a antibiotic ho, and isle chai usually anaerobic infection haru bhako condition ma anaerobic bacteria haru jasma oxygen nachaine condition huncha grow garnako lagi testo organism harle chai yele best kaam garcha bhanne kura ho hai aba usually gram positive gram negative bacteria ani ini haru chai usually hami jun kura garchau tyo aerobic bacteria haru hunchan त्यो एन्टिबायोटिक ले कभर गर्छ कहिले के एनएरोबिक ब्याक्टेरिया भयो भने चाहिँ मेट्रोनिडाजोल डिराजोल दिएर कभर गर्नुपर्ने हुन्छ त्यही हो व्हाट आर द कॉजेस अफ डीप सकेट एन्ड इट्स मेकानिजम हाउ डु वी म्यानेज इट आई थिंक दिस इज वेरी डीप दिस क्वेशन इटसेल्फ इज वेरी डीप एन्ड आई थिंक यसको कॉजेस र मेकानिजम धेरै ठुलो कुरा हुन्छ यो त्यति बुझ्नु सजिलो पनि छैन र गाह्रो पनि हुन्छ तिमीहरूलाई भनेर है सो लेट्स स्किप दिस है हाउ टु डिफरेन्सिएट बिट्विन नो नो नेक्स्ट क्वेशन कपिल जी एउटा क्वेशन आएको थियो जुन स्किप भयो त्योभन्दा पछाडि एउटा राकेश हाउ टु डायग्नोज एन्ड डिफरेन्सिएटेड Different feature of Graves' disease and exophthalmos. Okay, see exophthalmos, proptosis, and Graves' arthropathy usually used in a term. You say good question. It's my exophthalmos. Always remember it is proptosis due to thyroid eye disease. Hey, ani only proptosis matra edi bancho bani. There may be other causes like. Orbital tumor or bio, jun agi maile bhane tumor aru cause harle hune karan chha bhane. Forward bulging bhayo because of any other cause bhane that is proptosis bhanera bhanchau tesari bujchau hai tara exophthalmos edi bhanchau bhane chai proptosis due to thyroid eye disease bhanerai bujchau aru cause le haina bhanera bujchau hai ta
all right so these were the only question that our participant had raised
yeah.
so
okay thank you
to this screen share and I'm looking for some questions from the YouTube and the Zoom. So if you have any question, I request everyone to kindly drop your questions. I'll be taking every questions from you.
I'd like to clear one thing. I got one question in YouTube by Avilasa Acharya. Hello, anyone? Can you tell, please say for which year this is class? You're saying specifically your class, right? Your class one. It is meant to be useful for all ophthalmic practitioner, right? काम गरिरहेछ इभन पढिरहेको स्टुडेन्टलाई पनि काम लाग्छ पढिसकेर काम गर्न लागेको छ भने काम उसलाई काम लाग्छ इभन अप्थाल्मिक एसिस्टेन्ट अप्टोमेटिस्ट र इभन एमडी रेजिडेन्ट अप्थाल्मोलोजी डक्टर र दोज हु आर प्र्याक्टिसिङ अप्थाल्मोलोजी उनीहरूले पनि इट्स अ फर ब्रिफ रिभिजन यसलाई युज गर्न सक्छ एन्ड इट आई थिङ्क सम अफ द पोइन्ट्स दे आर युजफुल फर दोज हु आर प्रिपेयरिङ फर इन्ट्रान्स इक्जामिनेसन्सहरू है त्यो एमसिक्यूवाला पोइन्टहरू त्यही भएर इट इज लाइक everyone will get something out of this class hai mero main purpose chai tyo thiyo ra testai ni chha sayad hai yo kasko lagi specifically bhanera tyo chai haina tara hami alag alag group ma chai alag alag tesari chai garne chai garchau so this is meant for everybody who are interested in ophthalmology right
all right so this is the overview of our program so I'm looking for other question. I can see that some of the people asking 4 or 5 questions simultaneously. I request them please ask 1 or 2 questions only because you know, other people.
Okay, should I look at the Zoom chat box?
Yes, yeah, sir.
Okay. I can see the answers. Digital massage ko barema bhane yo pani bhayo hai causes of yo pani bhayo. I think most of the questions we have answered. What are the method of punctal occlusion? Manera sodheko cha. Punctal occlusion bhaneko aba tera it's if it is for temporary measures like sometimes huncha ni jastai anti-glaucoma drug har halda pani punctal occlusion garera garau athwa atropine halda kari systemic absorption kam hos bhanera punctal occlusion esari digitally garera garna sakinchha. Tara ke sodhna khojeko timle hai specifically maile bujhina main chai tyo ho ra arko punctal occlusion bhaneko dry eye ko condition ma when there is a drainage of टियर चाहिँ पंक्टमबाट नजाओस् र अकुलर सर्फेसमै त्यो टियर रहोस् भनेर के अरे सर्जिकली चाहिँ पंक्टल अक्लुजन गर्ने गरिन्छ जसलाई जसमा अब कटरी गरेर पनि गर्न सकिन्छ, कटरी गरेर पङ्क्टमलाई चाहिँ अक्लुड गर्न सकिन्छ, या त सर्जिकली चाहिँ पङ्क्टमलाई बन्द गर्ने काम पनि गर्न सकिन्छ, त्यसलाई चाहिँ पङ्क्टल अक्लुजन भनिन्छ, है त।
ओके, सो थैंक यू सो मच सर। आई कैन सी द वन क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम द मनीषा। सी इज आस्किंग फॉर सर, कैन यू प्लीज टेल मोर अबाउट द ड्रामेटिक रिस्पांस टू द स्ट्रोइड इन द ऑर्बिटल स्यूडो स्यूडो ट्यूमर्स।
या ओके, ड्रामेटिक रिस्पांस इन द सेंस आई मीन कि देखो स्यूडो ट्यूमर भन्ने डिजीज इज अ डायग्नोसिस अफ एक्सक्लूजन, है। नंबर वन, रिमेंबर दैट यू शुड रूल आउट अदर कॉजेज अफ प्रोप्टोसिस एंड अदर डिजीज फर्स्ट, then only if they are ruled out you can make a diagnosis of idiopathic this pseudo tumor, okay, idiopathic non specific orbital inflammation। ani esko euta characteristic feature ke huncha bhanda khari jastai hamile birami aayo proptosis cha ct scan garyo aba aru diagnosis banauna sakenau aba hamlai lagyo thi ke chai aba yo pseudo tumors to ho bhane short course ko lagi chai steroid dine oral steroid 1 mg per kg body weight diera 7 days ma heryo bhane एकदमै चट्टै ठिक भएको जस्तो त्यस्तो देखिन्छ के, यु विल बी एमेज एट द रेस्पोन्स। यति प्रोप्टोसिस भएर आएको 4 mm 5 mm प्रोप्टोसिस भएको बिरामी पनि 7 days ओरल स्टेरोइड खाएपछि टक्क त्यो प्रोप्टोसिस नै जान्छ के, सो द्याट इज द ड्रामेटिक रेस्पोन्स भनेको त्यो हो, त्यो चाहिँ यसमा देखिन्छ, यस्तो कन्डिसनमा देखिन्छ। समटाइम्स चाहिँ यस्तो ट्रायल पनि गरेर गर्न सकिन्छ, तर सबैले चाहिँ म एडभाइस गर्दिनँ यसरी गर्न, कन्सल्ट यो सिनियर स्पेसियल स्पेसियलिटीसँग रिलेटेड मान्छेसँग कन्सल्ट गरेर यो गर्न सकिन्छ, है त।
सो आई क्यान सी द अनदर क्वेशन बिफोर द्याट आई लाइक टु गो थ्रु द अभिलाषा क्वेशन्स, अभिलाषा इन्क्वायरी। सी इज सेइङ द्याट आई एम द फर्स्ट इयर स्टुडेन्ट एन्ड इट्स एभ्रिथिङ इज गोइङ फ्रम आउट अफ माइन्ड। सो अभिलाषा, आई रिक्वेस्ट टु गो देयर इन आवर वेबसाइट, सो देयर इज अल्सो बेसिक कोर्स available based on the anatomical stocks and all, so you can also find some of the videos on the YouTube, so maybe that this is the first level for you and then you can enroll into the Dr. Sabin course. So I can see another question from the Sanu Limbu. He is asking, sir, can you describe the role of cold compression and warm compression in eyelid swelling, especially in the case of trauma?
हुन त यो हामी ट्रमामा डिटेलमा पछि भन्नेछौँ, होइन, तर यो कहिले कोल्ड गर्ने कम्प्रेस गर्ने कहिले वार्म कम्प्रेस गर्ने भन्ने एकदम कन्फ्युजन हुन्थ्यो मलाई पनि, पहिला पहिला हुन्थ्यो है, तर आज पछि चाहिँ कहिले कन्फ्युजन नराख्नु। जहिले पनि एक्युट कन्डिसन छ भने कोल्ड कम्प्रेस गर्ने, है, एक्युट कन्डिसन इमिडिएटली भयो भने, अनि क्रोनिक कन्डिसन छ भने वार्म कम्प्रेसन गर्ने, अलवेज रिमेम्बर द्याट है। यसको मेकानिजम म भन्छु। अब कोल्ड भन्नाले के गर्छ भन्दा इमिडिएटली जब चोट लाग्यो, सपोज है ट्रमा भयो, स्वेलिङ भयो भने हाम्रो पर्पोज के हुन्छ भने त्यहाँको ब्लड भेसल्सहरूलाई कन्स्ट्रिक्ट गर्नु छ। कन्स्ट्रिक्ट गर्यो भने इन्फ्लामेटरी मिडिएटर्सहरू त्यहाँ आउन पाउँदैन र फर्दर इन्फ्लामेसनहरू बढाउन पाउँदैन। सो द्याट इज द मेकानिजम अफ द कोल्ड कम्प्रेसन। त्यही भएर आइस कम्प्रेसन गर्ने, इमिडिएटली चोट लाग्यो, इकेमिसिस भयो, ट्रमा भयो, कोल्ड कम्प्रेसन गर्ने के गर्छ, भेसो कन्स्ट्रिक्ट गर्छ, फर्दर इन्फ्लामेसनलाई बढाउँदैन, स्वेलिङलाई बढाउँदैन, है। तर यदि लङ क्रोनिक कन्डिसन छ, जस्तै रुमाटोइड आर्थराइटिस छ, जसमा इन्फ्लामेटरी कन्डिसनमा पनि धेरै समयदेखि क्रोनिक कन्डिसनदेखि भएको छ भने, त्यस्तो कन्डिसनमा के हुन्छ भने इन्फ्लामेटरी मिडिएटर्स आर अलरेडी प्रेजेन्ट एट द लोकल साइट, होइन, अलरेडी छँदैछ। अब हाम्रो पर्पोज के हुनु पर्यो भन्दा त्यसलाई बाहिर पठाउनु पर्यो। सो वार्म कम्प्रेस गर्यो भने के हुन्छ, भेसो डाइलेट गर्छ, भेसो डाइलेट गरेपछि दिज इन्फ्लामेटरी मिडिएटर्स दे टेन टु ड्रेन आउट फ्रम द्याट साइट, है। त्यही भएर अलवेज रिमेम्बर, कुनै कुनै एक्सेप्सन होला, इन जेनरलमा चाहिँ एक्युट कन्डिसन छ इमिडिएटली भएकोमा कोल्ड कम्प्रेस गर्ने, लङ प्रोसेस छ, क्रोनिक कन्डिसन छ भने वार्म कम्प्रेसन गर्ने, है त।
These way the question, so I can see the few of the question on our Zoom chat box.
I think we have limited time also. Okay,
so this is the last question that I will be answering. Yes, this is the last question that I'm taking from the
Okay, Sabin Singh Kuswara. Okay, I can see one question from Sabin Singh Kuswara. Advantage of endoscopic DCR over external DCR, Sabin Singh. You should answer this. तिमीले एन्सर गर्नुपर्छ मैले भन्ने हो। ल, इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआरको फाइदा के हो त, नाक बाट विथ थ्रू द नोज नेजल एप्रोच बाट जसमा नेजल म्युकोजालाई ओपन गरिन्छ त्यसपछि त्यहाँको मिडियल वाललाई ब्रेक गरिन्छ र ल्याक्रिमल स्याकमा ओपनिङ गरेर त्यहाँ प्यासेज बनाइन्छ है अब नाकबाट एप्रोच गर्ने त्यो भयो अनि एक्सटर्नल डिसिआर भनेको बाहिर स्किनबाट एक्सिजन दियो त्यसपछि ल्याक्रिमल स्याकमा एप्रोच गर्यो त्यहाँ इन्सिजन बनायो त्यसपछि बोन ब्रेक गर्यो नेजल म्युकोजामा इन्सिजन बनायो त्यसपछि त्यसमा प्यासेज बनायो है फरक के हुन्छ त एक्सटर्नल डिसिआरमा स्कार रहन्छ बाहिर स्किनमा इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआरमा भित्रतिर स्कार रहँदैन सो नम्बर वान डिफरेन्स इज द्याट अब त्यसले गर्दा के हो त कस्मेटिकली राम्रो हुने भयो युजली यङ फिमेलहरू छ अब भनौँ न कस्मेटिकली कन्सर्न मान्छेहरू छ भने उनीहरूको लागि चाहिँ इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर बेस्ट हुने भयो है अर्को एडभान्टेज अफ इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर भनेको अब बाहिर उन्ड रह्यो उन्डको हिलिङको कुराहरू तिनीहरू चाहिँ फास्ट हुने भयो र अर्ली रिकभरी त्यस्तो हुने भयो है अनि थर्डमा चाहिँ इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर चाहिँ एक्युट कन्डिसनहरूमा पनि गर्न सकिन्छ द्याट इज द मेन एडभान्टेजेस थिङ अफ इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर एक्सटर्नल डिसिआरमा चाहिँ एक्युट एपिसोड भएर त्यसको स्वेलिङहरू सबसाइड भएपछि एन्टिबायोटिकहरू इन्फ्लामेटरी कन्डिसन सबसाइड भएपछि बल्ल स्किनमा इन्सिजन लाउनु पर्ने छ नि त त्यहाँ होइन स्किनमा इन्सिजन लाएर सुचर लाउनुपर्छ त्यही भएर बाहिर स्वेलिङहरू भएको कन्डिसनमा हुँदैन तर इन्ट्रानेजल एप्रोचबाट चाहिँ हामीले के अरे एप्रोच गरेर त्यो इभन एक्युट कन्डिसनहरूमा पनि इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआरको आउटकम धेरै राम्रो छ भनेर रिसेन्टली अब धेरै पब्लिकेसनहरू त्यस्तो आइसकेको छ सो द्याट इज द भेरी गुड एडभान्टेज अफ इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर भने बेफाइदा के छ त हरेक सबै चिज फाइदा नै छ भन्ने हुँदैन बेफाइदा यो अलिकति लर्निङ कर्भ छ सिक्नको लागि त्यस्तै अलिकति चार्ज पनि बेसी पर्छ है एक्सटर्नल डिसिआर 6,000-8,000 पर्छ भने इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर त्यसको डबलभन्दा धेरै पर्न सक्छ अनि त्यसरी अनि फेलियर रेट पनि लगभग हेर्ने हो भने इन्डोस्कोपिकको कम्पेयरमा एक्सटर्नल चाहिँ बेटर मानिन्छ है इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर गरेर फेल भयो भने के गर्ने त एक्सटर्नल डिसिआर गर्ने हो क्या त्यही भएर आउटकम अथवा सक्सेस हुने चान्स चाहिँ प्रोग्नोसिस चाहिँ एक्सटर्नल डिसिआरको चाहिँ बेटर छ रेद कम्पेयर टु इन्डोस्कोपिक डिसिआर भनिन्छ बट द्याट अल्सो डिपेन्ड्स अन द सर्जन कस्तो छ उसको एक्सपिरियन्स कस्तो छ होइन टेक्निक कस्तो छ त्यसमा चाहिँ भर पर्छ है त
आई
थिङ्क द्याट क्लियर्स द एन्सर
थ्याङ्क यू सो मच डाक्टर सबिन फर योर टाइम एट दिस वन्डरफुल सेसन सो स्टिल आई क्यान सी द फ्यू मोर क्वेशन्स ओभर देयर आई ओब्वियसली गोना बी पुट दिस क्वेशन अन द chat YouTube mm-hmm. comment so mm-hmm. after whenever you have the time you can comment over there before ending the today's session I'd like to request if you have any good notes for your students or anything you want to share
so nothing specific as such ramri bhairacha right. sabai jana le enjoy garirachan jasto lagiracha hai yo chai अरूहरू पनि कतिजनाले गरिरहेछन् थाहा छैन क्लासको बारेमा भने सेयर गर्दा हुन्छ इन्फर्मेसनहरू दिँदा हुन्छ है
यस सो थ्याङ्क यू सो मच सर आई रिक्वेस्ट अल एन्ड एभ्री वान काइन्डली सेयर दिस कोर्स टु अल एन्ड एभ्री अफ युर फ्रेन्ड्स अन युर सर्कल बिकज वी आर डुइङ दिस इफ इट यु नो वी आर डक्टर सबिन पुटिङ अल द हार्ड सिफ प्रोभाइडिङ द यु नो one of the basic levels to maintain the one of the basic level for the ophthalmic assistant I hope you guys share this content to all over your circles so by saying this we'll be connecting you at next Sunday at the sharp 7:30 a.m. I hope you guys stay safe stay connected thank you so much thank you Dr. Sabin
thank you
thank you sir
thank you sir
welcome